हरे कृष्णा। व्हाट डू वी वांट इन लाइफ? वी ऑल वांट परफेक्ट लाइफ। एंड हाउ डू वी डिफाइन परफेक्ट लाइफ? परफेक्ट लाइफ हैज टू थिंग्स। फर्स्ट इज अ पर्पस एंड सेकंड इज अ हैप्पीनेस। व्हेन वी हैव अ वेरी स्ट्रांग पर्पस टू डू समथिंग एंड व्हेन वी डू दैट एंड अचीव दैट थिंग वी बिकम हैप्पी। And in life, we keep setting goals or a purpose at different time. And when we achieve those purpose, when we achieve those goal, we feel happy. And that's how our life goes on. But if you observe carefully, what happens is, we keep changing our purpose from time to time. And we keep searching for the happiness from time to time. For example, when we are a student, let us say you are studying in the 9th standard. We have a purpose. Oh, in the 10th standard, I should score 90%. And when I come to 10th standard and I score 90%, then that happiness of scoring 90% lasts for a few days. And then I keep another purpose for my life. In 12th standard, I should score 90% or I should top in my school. Then we carry on further. And in the 12th standard, when we score 90%, we feel happiness for a few days and then we keep a further purpose. After college, I should get this job. And for that job, for another 4 years, our life goes on. And after college, when we get the good job, still we are not satisfied that. We are not happy with that. We keep another purpose. We keep another goal. In this way, we keep changing our purpose, being dissatisfied or unhappy with the result of our last purpose. So is it all life about? Is the life all about searching and changing the purpose? No. Bhagavad Gita gives us a right purpose to live, gives us the way of living by which we can feel the happiness every day. We need not to set happiness as a goal, but rather live that happiness in our day-to-day life. How do we do that? What is the process of living happiness every day? The process of living happy every day is called yoga. Yes, that's why in this last 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, we studied 3 various yoga. In fact, the whole Bhagavad Gita is all about yoga. There are 4 types of yoga explained in the entire Bhagavad Gita. In the 3rd chapter, we studied Karma Yoga. In the 4th chapter, we studied Jnana Yoga. And then in the 6th chapter, we studied Sankhya Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga. And at the end of the 6th chapter, Krishna says, Yoginam api sarvesham madgate nantara atmana. Among all the yogis, one who is in me, one who remembers me constantly is a topmost yogi. So, the conclusion after explaining 3 yogas, Krishna gives that one who can always think of me, he is living the life in a yoga. He is living the perfect yoga life. And he is the one who can be happy all the time. Now, the 3 yoga which Krishna explained had some limitations because of which a person cannot remember Krishna for all the times. Now, Krishna is going to explain the final and the topmost yoga process by which a person can remember Krishna for all the time. What is that yoga? That yoga is a bhakti yoga. From chapter 7 to chapter 12, the details about bhakti yoga are explained. Starting with the chapter 7, in which Krishna explains why a person should always think of Krishna. Who is Krishna? The title of the chapter is given Knowledge of Absolute, or in other word, it's a knowledge of Krishna. When I say that we should always remember Krishna and then we can become happy, then the next question comes, why is it so? What makes Krishna so different from us? And what is that quality or what is that factor in Krishna because of which by remembering Krishna we can become happy? Or by connecting our life to Krishna, we can become happy. What is that thing in Krishna? So that Krishna explains in the 7th chapter that who is Krishna? This 7th chapter can be divided into 2 parts. First part from shloka number 1 to shloka number 12, it can be titled as who is Krishna? And second part of this chapter is from 13th shloka to 30th shloka, in which Krishna explains who can and who can't know Krishna. So let us get into the first portion of the chapter. Who is Krishna? In the second shloka of this chapter, Krishna explains, I am the source of both phenomenal and numinous world. What is this phenomenal and numinous world? Phenomenal means everything which we can see or which we can perceive through our senses. We have five senses on our body: eyes, nose, ears, skin and tongue. Through these five senses, we take a perception of the real world which is outside us. So this world which can be perceived through our five senses is called a phenomenal world. And above this, there is a numinous world or numinous things in this world. What are those numinous things? For example, consciousness or a soul. This consciousness or a soul we can experience, but we cannot perceive through our these five senses. That's why Krishna says this both the world, phenomenal as well as numinous, both are coming from me. I am the source. And in the fourth shloka, Krishna says, Bhumir apo nalo vayu kham mano budhirevacha ahankar iti yam me bhinna prakritir astada. This phenomenal world is made up of eight things. What are these eight things? Earth, water, air, ether, fire. And above these five things, mind, intelligence and ego. Everything which we see around us or which is living around us is made up of these living or non-living things, are made up of these eight things: earth, earthly element, water, air, ether, fire. Or in the living entities, there are three more things called mind, intelligence and ego. So these eight material elements are coming from me. That's what Krishna says in the fourth shloka. And then the numinous world, which consists of a soul mainly. So about that, Krishna says in the fifth shloka, Jiva Bhuto Mahabaho Yayeda Dharyate Jagat. The living entities, the soul, which are living in this world, who have taken over this Jagat, are also my parts. They are also coming from me. In this way, Krishna says in the final sixth shloka that Aham Krutasya Jagatah Prabhavah Pralayastatha. That I am the beginning of the entire creation and I am the end of the entire creation. So this is about Krishna, that who is Krishna. And to make this more clear, Krishna says in the seventh shloka, Matah parataram nanyat kinchid asti dhananjaya mai sarvam idam prote sutre manigana iva. There is nothing above me. Everything is coming from me, but I am not coming from anything. I am the supreme. I am cause of all the causes, but there is no cause for me. Many times people ask the question, oh, everything has a cause or everything is being created. Then who created God? So the answer Krishna says here in the Bhagavad Gita, seventh shloka of this particular seventh chapter is Matah parataram nanyat, that above me there is nothing. And mai sarvamidam prote sutre maniganaiva, everything outside Krishna is resting on Krishna as if the pearls are resting on the necklace. So Krishna is like a thread of the entire existence. That's what is explained in the seventh shloka. And in the further shlokas, Krishna says, to explain this with a practical example, he gives or he cites few examples like this. I am the taste of water. I am the light of sun and moon. I am syllable Om in the Vedic mantras. I am the sound. I am ability in men. I am heat in fire. I am life of all that lives. I am prowess of all powerful men. There are so many abilities which we see around, or which we see in a people around us. All those abilities are given to those people by Krishna only, based on their karma, of course. And then further Krishna says, I am the sex life which is not contrary to religion or religious principles. And furthermore, in the final 12th shloka, Krishna says, practically I am everything.
So Krishna has established his position as a supreme personality of Godhead in the 7th chapter from shloka number 1 to shloka number 12. After hearing to this shloka, we should not have any doubt about the position of Krishna as a supreme person or a God. Now, if with this understanding, if we go further, we see that there are a lot of people around us who don't believe in God or who can't accept Krishna as a God. Then why is it so? If Krishna is a God and he is everything and we should live in connection with him, and then only we can become happy, and everyone wants happiness in this world, then why people are not accepting Krishna and why people are not ready to get connected with Krishna? Why don't people live or get connected with Krishna and become happy? Why do people keep finding their own ways of living? So that is explained in the further part of this chapter, who can and who can't know Krishna. In the 13th shloka, Krishna explains why somebody can't understand him. When a person is controlled by the three modes called Sattvagun, Rajogun and Tamogun, then in such a conditioned life, he cannot accept or he cannot understand Krishna. And in the 14th shloka, Krishna explains who can understand Krishna. One who surrenders to Krishna, or one who is ready to accept Krishna, mameya prapadyante, he can understand Krishna. Now, in a 15th and 16th shloka, more details are given about the people who can accept Krishna and start worshipping or start connecting himself with Krishna, and the people who can't accept Krishna or who will not be ready to accept Krishna and connect with him. So that is explained in the 15th and 16th shloka. In the 15th shloka, Krishna says, four kind of people can never surrender unto him or can never accept him. What are these four kind of people? First is a mudha or a foolish people. Then second is a naradhama, a people whose consciousness is like that of animals, who are only thinking about four things: eating, sleeping, enjoying and protecting himself. If a person is always engaged in these four activities only, then in such a state he will not be able to understand Krishna, or he will not be ready to accept Krishna. Then third kind of person is maya aprahata jnana. A person may be very much intelligent, but if he is under the illusory concept of life, then he cannot accept Krishna as a God. What is the illusion? Illusion is that I am the controller of everything and I can understand everything because everything is happening by chance. If a person has accepted the idea or such an idea of illusory concept of everything, then he cannot accept Krishna as God. Then finally, fourth kind of people who cannot accept Krishna are asurim bhavam ashritaha. Somebody who has accepted the nature of demons. What is the nature of demon? Who are very unclean in their habits, who are always envious from others, who are always greedy, who are always angry. If somebody has accepted such kind of a nature for living, then such kind of people, or such asuric people, or such a demoniac people cannot accept Krishna as a God. In the 16th shloka, four types of people are explained who will accept Krishna as a God and who will surrender unto Krishna. What are these four kind of people? First one is Artho. Artho means one who is in distress or who is going through some problem. When a person goes through a problematic situation and when he tries his best to solve all the problems, and when he fails solving the problem, naturally it humbles him, and in a such a state he accepts Krishna, or he accepts God's existence or God's control over everything, and then he will try to understand and approach God. That is the first type, Artho. Then second is a Jigyasu. Jigyasu means a person who has a jigyasa to know the purpose of everything, or who is inquiring always that how things are running around him. What is the ultimate cause of all the causes? If a person has such a jigyasa to know, then in that state he will be able to understand Krishna. Then the third type of people are called Artharthi. Artharthi means a person who wants something. He's trying his best to get some money or some fame, but he's not able to get it. In such a state, he will approach God and request God or pray to God for gaining those things. So this is called Artharthi. And finally, the fourth type of people who are the most wise among the all fourth are called Jnani, who have understood by studying scriptures or by understanding the whole Vedas that yes, Krishna is a cause of everything. Then he will approach Krishna or he will surrender unto Krishna. In this regard, there is one beautiful incident explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam Puran that how one person in a very distressful situation or in a want of something approach God and happens to see Krishna. So it starts long back. There was a king called Uttanapad. He had two wives. One was Suruchi and another was Suniti. From both the wife, he had one child. So one day it so happened that King Uttanapad was sitting on his simhasan and his favorite wife Suruchi was sitting next to him. And Suruchi's son happened to sit on the lap of King Uttanapad and King Uttanapad was playing around with the boy. That time, the child of another wife, Suniti, his name was Dhruva. So this Dhruva happens to come there. And by seeing that his younger brother is sitting on the father's lap, he also desires to sit on the father's lap. And he moves forward and tries to climb on the father's lap. At that very moment, Suruchi, the other wife of King Uttanapad, stops Dhruva Maharaj. And very harshly, she tells, "Oh child, if you want to sit on that lap, you have to take birth from my womb." And when Dhruva Maharaj hears these piercing words, he becomes extremely angry and he becomes extremely sad. And in such a state, he runs away from that place to the place where his mother was sitting. And he goes to his mother and start crying and start yelling loudly that, "Oh mother, I also want to sit on my father's lap. I also want to sit on my father's lap." And at that time, Suniti, becoming very sad and understanding the whole situation, she also becomes very upset. But what can be done? She knows she don't have any ability or she don't have any right over the king. Knowing the situation very well and finding herself helpless, replies to the Dhruva Maharaj that, "My dear child, I can't help you. I don't know what to do in this situation." At that time, Dhruva Maharaj answers back to Suniti, "Then who can help me?" And Suniti replies, "Only Narayan can help you." And then Dhruva Maharaj further asks, "Where is this Narayan? Where I can find him?" And Suniti starts thinking about it. And then she tells, "Oh well, I have heard that great sages find Narayan in the forest. So probably he may be living in the forest." And when Dhruva Maharaj hears this, immediately he starts walking out of the palace and he starts moving forward in the direction of jungles. And he was very much determined that he want to find Narayana and he will take help from Narayana and climb on the lap of Uttanapad, his father. In this mood, Dhruva Maharaj is going forward towards the jungle. And when Dhruva Maharaj is walking toward the jungle, Narad Muni happens to pass by. And when he sees that this Dhruva, this child, young child, is walking towards the jungle, he, with his mystic power, comes to know that Dhruva Maharaj is going to jungle in the search of Narayan. Then he takes the compassion on the Dhruva Maharaj and goes toward the Dhruva Maharaj and tells the boy that, "My dear child, where are you going?" "Oh, I am going to jungle." "Oh, why are you going to jungle in such a tender age?" "Well, I am in search of Narayana. I want to find Narayana. That is why I am going to jungle. If you can help me, please help. If you can't help me, then please go out of my way." And when Narad Muni hears this innocent word of the child, he becomes very happy and very compassionate. And just to taste Dhruva Maharaj's determination, he asks Dhruva Maharaj, "Well, you are just a child. Go back to your palace. When you become young, that time you can come. and find Narayana in the jungle. It's very difficult to find him in jungle, and this jungle are very dangerous. When Dhruva Maharaj hears this, he becomes angry that, well, if you can't help me, get out of my way. Please don't waste my time, and if you can help me, then only talk to me. Narad Muni, when he hears these words, he becomes very happy, and immediately he tells, okay, well, I'll help you. Now you go on the bank of Yamuna in the Madhuvan, and in that place you start chanting this mantra, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. And Dhruva Maharaj, when he hears this mantra, he becomes very happy and goes to the place which was directed by Narad Muni. And after reaching the place, Dhruva Maharaj, with a very strong determination, starts chanting this mantra, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. And after 6 months, Lord Narayana himself comes to that place to bless Dhruva Maharaj. And when Dhruva Maharaj opens his eyes and see Narayana standing in front of him, he becomes ecstatic with the happiness. And in that ecstatic mood, he wants to offer praise to Narayana. And that time Narayana, Lord Narayana, touch Dhruva Maharaj's head with his conch. And then Dhruva Maharaj beautifully composes the prayers. After that, Lord Narayana asks to Dhruva Maharaj, that, my dear child, what do you want? And Dhruva Maharaj replies, oh my Lord, I was searching for the broken pieces of glass, and now I have found the jewel. Now I don't want anything. And when Lord Narayana hears this statement, he becomes very happy and awards Dhruva Maharaj with the planet, the kingdom called Dhruva planet, which is the topmost kingdom in the entire creation or entire Brahmanda. Well, Dhruva Maharaj had started worshipping Narayana, or had gone to search Narayana only with the purpose to satisfy his desire of having a kingdom or a desire of sitting on the throne of his father. But when he saw Narayana, when he got Krishna, that time he became purified of that desire, and he did not want anything further. So the point here is, the four type of people, Artho, Artharthi, Jigyasu and Jnani. These four kind of people approach Krishna with some purpose, but there is nothing wrong in that. Nowadays many people say that, oh, because we are fearful or because we are in a want of something, we are going to God. So well, there is nothing wrong in that. When a child, he wants something, or when a child is fearful about something, he naturally approaches his father. It's a natural tendency of the child to take shelter of a father. Similarly, it's a natural tendency of a soul to take shelter of God. There is nothing wrong in it. In the further portion of this chapter, Krishna explains, among the people who want to approach Krishna, who want to surrender Krishna, there are two type of people, who directly surrender to Krishna and who indirectly surrender to Krishna. The first, from 20th shloka to 25th shloka, Krishna explains about the people who indirectly surrenders to Krishna. Who are these people? Kamesterte ritagyana. Somebody who has a strong desires of enjoying for himself alone. Such kind of people will go to Krishna indirectly. How indirectly? They'll not approach Krishna directly, but they'll approach demigods or a devta. Why so? Because these devta will immediately or very easily fulfill the material desire of a person. So that's why these people will go to Krishna through the devta, who are also, of course, under the control of Krishna only. And this devta can award something to the person or give something to the person only and only by sanction of Krishna. So these people, kamesterte ritagyana, whose heart are filled with a strong desire to enjoy for himself, this type of people will approach demigods or a devta, or indirectly to Krishna. And why not directly surrender to Krishna? Ichha dvesha samutthena dvandva mohena bharata. There are two reasons for which they are not directly going to Krishna, but indirectly going to Krishna, or indirectly they are going through the demigods or a devta. What are the two reasons? Ichha and dvesha. First, I already explained ichha, that strong desire to enjoy for himself, and dvesha, Dvesha means envious. They are envious of Krishna. They are envious of God. How they are envious of God? Oh, they are thinking themselves to be God. They know that Devta are superior to them, but they don't accept these Devtas as a God. They accept Devta as a more powerful people. That's all. So in such an envious state, these people don't approach Krishna directly and they indirectly surrender to Krishna. Now in the 28th to 30th shloka, Krishna explains about the people who will directly approach Krishna. Who are these people who will directly approach Krishna? Esham tva antagatam papam janana punyakarmanam. People who have got rid of all the sinful activities, who have stopped doing sinful activities and have done lot of punya or lot of pious activities. That means people who have no more self-centered desire. They want to see others happy or they want to do good to others, doing lot of punya activities. These kind of people can approach Krishna directly or will surrender. When they come to know about Krishna, they directly surrender to Krishna. And then in the 29th shloka, Krishna explains, Jara marano mokshaya. Somebody who has been tired of taking birth again and again in this world, janma mrityu jara vyadhi. That birth, death, old age and disease. Somebody who understands that these four are the prime problem of life. Birth, death, old age and disease. And now he wants to get rid of this cycle of birth and death. In such a state, the person will directly approach Krishna. He will directly surrender to Krishna. And then in the 30th shloka, finally Krishna explains, Sadhi Bhutadhi Daivam. Somebody who has understood that Krishna is Adhidaivam, he is ultimate Deva, ultimate controller of everything, of all the Jivas, all the Bhutas, all living entities. Krishna is the supreme and he is the ultimate controller. If somebody accepts this, somebody comes to know about this, in that state, he will accept Krishna, he will directly surrender to Krishna. So, this was the 7th chapter all about. The 7th chapter titled as a knowledge of absolute was divided into two portions. First portion from 1st to 12, who is Krishna? Second portion from 13th to 30th shloka, who can and who can't understand or know Krishna. So we will conclude this 7th chapter here, and in the 8th chapter onward, we'll start understanding the process of devotional service, the process or a practical aspect of Bhakti Yoga. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Understand what you learned from this chapter by filling a simple form whose link is given in the description. It will make you eligible for receiving the certificate. You can also type all the questions which you have in the same form and we'll answer them through email. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any updates.